हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी विल स्टडी अबाउट द प्रिपरेशन ऑफ फ्यू अदर सॉल्ट्स. द फर्स्ट वन इज कैल्शियम कार्बोनेट. सी द रिएक्शन विद विच वी विल ऑब्टेन कैल्शियम कार्बोनेट, इट्स प्रेसिपिटेशन रिएक्शन. प्रेसिपिटेशन रिएक्शन मीन्स डबल डिकम्पोजिशन प्रेसिपिटेशन रिएक्शन इन विच वी टेक टू एक्वस सॉल्यूशंस एंड द प्रोडक्ट विच आर फॉर्म्ड आउट ऑफ द टू प्रोडक्ट्स फॉर्म्ड वन इज ऑब्टेन्ड इन अ प्रेसिपिटेट फॉर्म. So here we'll take calcium chloride, aqueous solution of calcium chloride will mix with aqueous solution of sodium carbonate. When these two aqueous solutions are mixed together, as soon as we'll mix them, we'll see that insoluble white colored PPT is obtained. Okay, so see, mixed together and stirred, a white precipitate of insoluble calcium carbonate is obtained. It is insoluble. That's why it is called a precipitate, which separates out from the aqueous solution. And then we will filter it. NaCl will come down or wherever we'll collect it. Okay. And calcium carbonate, it will remain there in the filter paper. This calcium carbonate, which is there obtained as in the form of precipitate, this precipitate it is dried to obtain an amorphous powder, and that powder is called calcium carbonate. Okay, now with the neutralization reaction we'll prepare copper sulfate. Copper and sulfate we are preparing. It means neutralization reaction is there, it means the hydroxide will be of copper, and sulfate is there, it means sulfuric acid we have to take. Okay, see, out of these two we can take any. We can take copper oxide also and copper hydroxide also, because we have read it earlier also that these both are basic in nature. Since they both will act in a similar manner, it means we can take any of these two. So if we'll take copper oxide and we'll add sulfuric acid to it, then we'll get blue colored solution of copper sulfate in water. And if we'll take copper hydroxide and we'll add sulfuric acid to it, then too we'll obtain copper sulfate and here we'll get two molecules of water. Okay, here only one molecule will be obtained and here we'll obtain two molecules of water. See, when we have taken copper hydroxide, so whether we are taking oxide or hydroxide, here we'll obtain same products. Now see, step one is there, like take dilute sulfuric acid in a beaker. In a beaker we'll take dilute sulfuric acid and we'll add either copper oxide or hydroxide we'll add. Okay, then we'll stir it and we will keep stirring it till no more residue will remain there at the bottom. Now we'll filter this, and filtration is done. If any impurity is there, then we'll filter it out. After filtration, the filtrate which is obtained here, the filtrate, it is taken in an evaporating dish. In this evaporating dish, we'll take that filtrate and we'll heat it. Crystallization process we have studied earlier. We will heat it till its saturated solution is made, and we'll then cool the hot saturated solution. And upon cooling this hot saturated solution, we will obtain the crystals of copper sulfate pentahydrate. They'll crystallize out, and these are the crystal, they'll be obtained like this. And yes, they will be blue in color, and the blue color and the shape of the crystals, it is because of this water of crystallization, .5H2O. Okay, now neutralization of an alkali. Here we'll do it by the process of titration, and we'll prepare sodium sulfate. See, sodium and sulfate we'll prepare. It means sodium hydroxide and sulfuric acid we have to take. Similarly, like sodium hydroxide we have taken, if we'll take KOH, then too the same type of reaction will occur. See, here we'll fill this. This is a burette. This is called burette, and this flask is called conical flask, or we can also call it titration flask. Okay, we'll add few drops of phenolphthalein in this NaOH. And phenolphthalein, we have studied that phenolphthalein, it turns pink in a base. It will turn pink. And here we have filled this burette with dilute sulfuric acid. Now we'll add this dilute sulfuric acid in this NaOH drop by drop. We'll keep adding it drop by drop and we'll keep shaking this also. And we'll observe that this pink color will keep on fading as we'll add this sulfuric acid to it. We'll see that it will keeps on fading, and the point at which the color just decolorizes will just close the tap. Okay, this tap of the burette will just close it. It means now this NaOH has been completely neutralized by this acid. That is the neutralization point or the end point. Okay, because the pink color phenolphthalein was turning pink in NaOH, and now we are adding sulfuric acid to it, and at that drop where the pink color of this phenolphthalein will completely neutralize, it means at that point this is completely neutralized by the sulfuric acid. Yes, and what will be formed here? Sodium hydroxide is here. This is sulfuric acid. It means sodium sulfate is formed here. This sodium sulfate, it is again taken in a dish where it is heated to the point of crystallization, and then this hot saturated solution, it is cooled, and upon cooling we will get the crystals of Na2SO4.10H2O, sodium sulfate decahydrate. Now see the properties of salts, general properties like action of dilute acid on salt. See, we know that if any carbonate or bicarbonate is taken, and if we'll add acid to that carbonate or bicarbonate, we'll get salt, water and carbon dioxide. This we know. Any bicarbonate or bicarbonate, when acid is added to it, will get salt, water and carbon dioxide. And see the last reaction, it's very important. If we have taken any sulfide, FeS, iron sulfide or ferrous sulfide, if sulfide we have taken and we'll add sulfuric acid to it, we'll get ferrous sulfate and H2S. Here when we have taken carbonate, we were obtaining carbon dioxide gas. When we have taken sulfide, then we will obtain H2S, hydrogen sulfide gas, and see it is left here. If we have taken sulfite, SO3, SO3 is sodium sulfite. When sodium sulfite is there and we will add HCl to it, here we will get salt, water and SO2 gas. So if carbonate or bicarbonate are there, salt, water and CO2. If sulfite is there, then salt, water and SO2. And if sulfide is there, then salt and H2S gas. Okay, now see hydrolysis of salt. See it very carefully. Like suppose we have taken a weak alkali and a strong acid. Weak alkali, ammonium hydroxide, it is a weak alkali, and strong acid is HCl. See, if base is weak and acid is strong, it means the salt which we will obtain, it will be an acidic salt. Okay, when base is weak and acid is strong, then we will obtain an acidic salt, NH4Cl, along with the formation of water. Base plus acid gives salt and water. Now see here, the base we have taken, it's strong, and the acid which we have taken, it is a weak acid. So strong base and weak acid, the salt which we will obtain will have basic nature. It will be a basic salt. See, just by looking at this salt, we can identify whether the salt is acidic or basic. It is Na, it means it has been obtained from NaOH, and it is CO3, means H2CO3, weak acid. It means this will be a basic salt. And look here, the last one, NaOH and HCl, both are strong. When both are strong, then the salt which is obtained is neutral. So strong acid and weak base, acidic salt. Strong base, weak acid, basic salt. And strong acid, strong base, neutral salt. And if both of the bases in acid, they will be weak, then again we will get a neutral salt. Okay, now the reverse of this they have done here. Here they have taken ammonium chloride, and when this ammonium chloride is dissolved in water, ammonium it will react with OH to form NH4OH and HNCl HCl. It means weak alkali and strong acid. It means that this solution will be acidic. Strong acid is there, acidic. If NaOH, it is the reverse of this. Yes, if sodium bicarbonate is there and water is added to it, we'll get Na is there, means strong alkali, and CO3 is there, means H2CO3 only, weak acid, strong alkali and weak acid, alkaline solution. Sodium carbonate means sodium hydroxide and H2CO3, again sodium hydroxide and H2CO3 means strong alkali and weak acid, again the alkaline solution. Here NaCl and water, NaCl means NaOH and HCl, strong alkali, strong acid means neutral solution. Okay, so you have to keep these points in your mind, like if acid is strong and base is weak, then the salt will be acidic. If base is strong, acid is weak, then the salt will be basic. And if both are strong, then salt will be neutral. Now, there are the some properties which you have already studied in class 9. Like, salts are non-volatile, they are electrovalent compounds, they have high melting, since they are electrovalent, so they are having high melting and boiling points. They are soluble or insoluble in water and they exhibit deliquescence and efflorescence. Now first we'll study about the water of crystallization. We know that it is the amount of water molecule which is in loose chemical combination with a compound. Here, see, this is a compound, suppose CaSO4, and dot 2H2O which is attached to this compound or this molecule, it is called water of crystallization. And this water of crystallization, it gives color and shape to the crystals. Okay, this is CaSO4.2H2O, gypsum, copper sulfate, pentahydrate, blue vitriol, calcium chloride, hexahydrate, magnesium sulfate, heptahydrate, Epsom salt, sodium sulfate, decahydrate, Glauber's salt, and sodium carbonate, decahydrate, washing soda. There are two terms, deliquescence and efflorescence. Deliquescence is what? When these salts, they absorb moisture from the atmosphere. When they are kept open in the atmosphere, they absorb moisture from there. And when they absorb moisture, they change into a solution. And efflorescence means it is the crystalline hydrated salt which on exposure to the atmosphere, when they are exposed to the atmosphere, they lose their water of crystallization partly or completely. And when they lose their water of crystallization, they change into a powder. See, copper sulfate, pentahydrate, these are the examples which lose their water of crystallization when they are kept open in the atmosphere. And